حتى في
In the year of 1886, in the town of Atlanta, Georgia, a man named John Pemberton created a beverage that would become an American icon. John Pemberton was enlisted as a first lieutenant in the Confederate Army during the Civil War. During his last battle, Pemberton was wounded and used morphine for his pain, eventually becoming addicted to morphine. After the war, he moved to Columbus, Georgia, where he began the practice of pharmacy. There, he tried to create a medical concoction that would become commercially successful. Unfortunately, he did not have any success with any of his inventions, so he decided to move to Atlanta, Georgia, where he created a new formula for what he called a cure-all beverage. Although that new formula would become what is today the biggest selling soft drink, he might not have gone anywhere if it were not for his bookkeeper, Frank Robinson. Robinson came up with a name that they both thought was catchy, Coca-Cola. Since Robinson was a bookkeeper, he wrote the name in a Spencerian script, which was popular in bookkeepers during that era. His script will become the logo of their company and remain nearly the same since then. On June 28, 1887, Jacob's Pharmacy in Atlanta, Georgia was the first place to serve Coca-Cola from a soda fountain. From there, he sold about 9 glasses of cola a day. Unfortunately, even with the catchy name and elegant logo, Pemberton only sold about 25 gallons of cola syrup his first year. He made about $50 his first year, however, he had expenses of about $70. On August 1888, before Pemberton could get to taste the fortune he dreamed of, he died of stomach cancer. John Pemberton never saw what his secret formula would amount to. Coca-Cola might have died that year if it were not for a man named Asa Griggs Candler. When Frank Robinson initially asked Candler to invest in Coca-Cola, Candler said no. But sometime later, Candler tasted Coca-Cola for the first time. That one drink made Candler realize what an opportunity he had in front of him.
Asa Candler saw possibilities in Coca-Cola that John Pemberton did not see.
One can make the argument that the glass of Coca-Cola served to Candler was the most important of all. By 1891, Candler had become the full owner of Coca-Cola. He bought it off for about $2,300. Right away, Coca-Cola sales began to rise in Atlanta. Candler knew he could get more out of Coca-Cola, so he began to push out advertisements.
In 1890, Coca-Cola published their logo wherever the consumer went, like notebooks, calendars, and posters.
Experts say that a main reason Coca-Cola has had a huge commercial success was because of its advertising. However, Coca-Cola did have a bad image at one point.
There were rumors that cocaine was an added ingredient to the formula.
According to CNBC, Coca-Cola was originally marketed as a cure-all, which supposedly treated conditions as headaches and morphine addiction, among others. In the late 19th century, it was not uncommon for trace amounts of cocaine to turn up in medically dubious tonics and potions. As such, the product was named for cola nuts and extract of coca leaves, the two ingredients that were considered medicinal at the time. By the late 1890s, Coca-Cola was being served at soda fountains all across the United States. However, sales were being limited to those soda fountains. No one was able to pick up a bottle of Coca-Cola to take home. However, Candler wasn't worried about that. He was pretty much happy already. It was up to Benjamin Franklin Thomas and Joseph White to invent the iconic Coca-Cola bottle. Candler didn't want to go into the bottling business because it was too expensive and difficult. He decided, however, to sell Coca-Cola to Franklin and Joseph. They then would bottle the Coca-Cola and resell it without having to pay any royalty to Candler. In the year 1919, Candler thought that soft drinks were as big as they were going to get, and so he sold the company to a group of investors headed by Ernest Woodruff and W.C. Bradley for $25 million, which was the largest money transaction at that time. 4 years later, Ernest Woodruff's son, Robert Woodruff, was elected president of the company. It was Robert's leadership and new ideas that took Coca-Cola to unimaginable heights. An example of his ideas was the world's first six-pack.
Coca-Cola was the first company to invent the six-pack, but up until then, people kept on buying it one by one.
The idea of selling the consumer six bottles of Coca-Cola instead of one was considered genius. Another one of Woodruff's ideas was that Coca-Cola could become an international drink, not just one in the U.S. England, Mexico, and Cuba were one of the first countries to be introduced to Coca-Cola. The first bottling company on the European continent was located in France. Something the company had to overcome was the fact that its product was highly popular during the summer, but not so much during the winter. This is when they came up with the classic Santa Claus advertisement.
Coca-Cola added the Santa Claus ad to boost winter sales.
Coca-Cola tried to get people to buy during the winter months, so they decided to connect their product to the holidays. The original artist, Vidon Sablanc, said he wanted to create a Santa Claus that was opposite from what he saw in Chicago, which were skinny old alcoholics standing around the streets dressed as Santa Claus. On October of 1929, the world experienced the longest, most widespread, and deepest depression of the 20th century. While many businesses, including banks, failed, Coca-Cola sales stayed high.
During the Great Depression, Coca-Cola's sales stayed really high because everyone out there could really afford a 5-cent drink back then.
Many people looked to the drink as a time of happiness when the world around them was dying. They had an emotional tie to the beverage. In 1955, Coca-Cola introduced bigger bottles.
Coca-Cola got the idea to invent a bigger size of bottle, so they got size of regular, king, and family size.
It made it easier for the consumer to take home. Rather than carrying several bottles, they would simply carry one large one. During the 1950s, when television was getting big, Coca-Cola began making commercials. But since there weren't many commercials then, they would instead sponsor entire TV series and incorporate their product into the program. During the 1980s, Coca-Cola sales began to decline. The company began to worry if the people had grown tired of the cola flavor, and so they created a new flavor of Coca-Cola that had won taste tests all around the country. The company decided to switch to the new Coca-Cola formula, and on April 23rd, 1985, they announced it to the world.
Coca-Cola tried to introduce a new flavor, but people demanded the original flavor to stay.
The people loved the new taste better, but they had an emotional bind to the old formula. They couldn't get past the idea of changing something so fundamental to their society. And so by the end of the year, the company switched back to Coca-Cola Classic. Since 1886, Coca-Cola has become more than just a soft drink. It has become a symbol of coming together. No matter what country you live in, or society you are a part of, or religion you choose to follow, everyone knows the classic logo.
Coca-Cola was more than a soft drink. It was more of a universal icon.
Coca-Cola is simply something for all to enjoy.